A long time ago, in a faraway kingdom, there lived a storyteller. He used his experience as a teller of fairy tales, combined with his love of new technology, to tell a classic story of the triumph of good over evil, with memorable characters, told with stunning art and animation. A classic film that has been beloved by generations. Join the celebration as we explore the magic behind-the-scenes story of Walt Disney's dazzling masterpiece, Sleeping Beauty.
It's always a challenge bringing a great story classic to the screen, giving visual form to characters and places that have only existed in the imagination. But it's the kind of challenge we enjoy.
Well, Walt had built his feature film output on the cornerstone of Snow White and the Seven Dwarfs. That was the first feature the studio attempted. It was, you know, wildly successful beyond anyone's expectations. But it became sort of the comparison point for everything that followed.
Disney began the ambitious plans for his third feature-length animated fairy tale in the early 1950s. Walt assigned a small team to begin adapting the classic fairy tale to the style of a Disney feature.
Yeah, I think it was at least as early as 52. We thought it was real great. It had some little gnomes-type fairies. It was a whole different type of picture.
This early work resulted in a completed storyboard presentation in June of 1952. Walt concluded, however, that this story approach was too similar to past Disney efforts. If the Disney staff returned to the fairy tale, they could not simply duplicate Snow White or Cinderella.
Walt took this on, I think, as a special challenge. He wanted to make this film as special and as different as he could. He wanted to make a film that he felt would be the pinnacle of achievement in animation.
This fresh approach to Sleeping Beauty would push the boundaries of animation with its distinctive and exquisite art.
My gift shall be the gift of beauty.
They wanted it to look different from any other film they had made before, and in this they were aided immeasurably by a very gifted artist named Eyvind Earle, who came up with a very stylized and modern look for the film.
I came to work for Disney's in 1951, more than 10 years after I first tried to get into the studio. Of course, it was the greatest job in the whole world for me, and I remember Walt saying, "Let's see what Ivan can do."
In searching for a style for a cartoon feature, many considerations are necessary. For one thing, it must be more than merely pleasing to the eye. The backgrounds must harmonize with the animated characters, as well as fit the mood of the story and the music. Sleeping Beauty is a fairy tale that is supposed to have taken place long, long ago. So we did a great amount of research into medieval painting and architecture before we arrived at the right styling for this picture.
Eyvind Earle's unique and modern graphic style perfectly realized Walt's desire to create what he called a moving illustration.
I've always been influenced by pre-Renaissance, medieval, Gothic, and here's a movie based on that period of time.
If you look at the old Master Van Eyck, you can see details on bushes miles away. As if everything in the whole picture is absolutely clear. And Ivan felt that way about this. It's a fairy tale, let's make it like that. You'll notice that all the design in it is absolutely vertical or horizontal. Everything in it is based on these two juxtapositions, these two planes, including the characters.
I first started with the old medieval artists and almost everything that was Gothic. The tapestries were perfect examples of how foregrounds ought to be. The Gothic came from the Persians, and all their little details of grasses and weeds and trees fit perfectly. So I realized I could use anything that was in harmony with what I was striving to accomplish. And over all of that, a little tiny bit of myself came through.
I think in order to appreciate the complexity of the art and the amount of work that was done, you'd have to mount a museum exhibition to be able to study it.
Walt's team of experienced animators faced a particular challenge, making their characters live believably within this highly stylized world.
It's always been said the toughest thing to sell to an audience in an animated film is a believable human figure. And Mark Davis was the champion of female figures at Disney.
Every one of these films that we did has kind of a style all of its own.
We had decided to do Sleeping Beauty as what Walt called a moving illustration. So we did a style in there that was different from any other Disney film. We stylized the drawing of Briar Rose.
They never want me to meet anyone. And just before we say goodbye, he takes me in his arms. And then I wake up.
I had a young woman do some live action reference for me. Her name was Helene Stanley. And she did the dances and this sort of thing, which you could do on your own, but that's doing it the hard way. Why not have something you could refer to?
The climactic battle between Prince Philip and the dragon was also intricately choreographed in live action for use as a reference by the animators. It is shown here for the first time in footage reconstructed from the only surviving still photos of the live action.
Up this way!
Mark Davis commanded the forces of both good and evil in Sleeping Beauty. He also supervised the design and animation of the cruel and elegant Maleficent.
I looked through books of the Middle Ages and so on. Then I found some figure that was kind of a religious nature, but a part of the gown were these kind of medallions of red and they had a look of flames, and I thought, gee, that's a good idea. And then, since she was kind of evil, I decided, well, the horns of the devil, it wouldn't hurt, so I put the horns on. And then around her neck, kind of like bat wings.
To give Maleficent a powerful voice to match her evil character, Walt Disney personally suggested actress Eleanor Audley, who had brought Cinderella's wicked stepmother, Lady Tremaine, to chilling vocal life.
Well, Eleanor Audley was a fine actress. There's a lot of the facial look that I put into Maleficent that really is Eleanor Audley.
I really felt quite distressed at not receiving an invitation.
You weren't wanted.
Not what? Oh dear, what an awkward situation. I had hoped it was merely due to some oversight. Well, in that event, I'd best be on my way.
Veteran animators Frank Thomas and Ollie Johnston were given the happy task of bringing three good fairies to life.
At one point, Walt wanted the three fairies to all be alike, sort of like Huey, Dewey, and Louie. And we thought, that's not going to be any fun. So we started figuring it the other way and worked on how we could develop them into special personalities.
I think it did make the picture richer to have them that way. Little Merriweather was a feisty little thing that get upset real easy. Fauna was always the one trying to say, for a while on troubled waters, to keep peace between Flora and Merriweather. Because Flora was not what you'd call an appointed leader. She just automatically sort of became the leader because she had the best ideas. But all in all, the three of them formed a happy team.
During the production of Sleeping Beauty, voice recordings and live-action reference films were made by many of Hollywood's best-known character actresses, including Spring Byington, Madge Blake, and even Mayberry's Aunt Bee, Frances Bavier. As animation progressed, another gift was being given to the production of Sleeping Beauty.
My gift shall be the gift of song.
Our inspiration for Sleeping Beauty was this wonderful score written more than 75 years ago by Peter Tchaikovsky for his ballet version of the fairy tale.
Bringing much of this music to life was a lovely young singer whose performance as both the singing and speaking voice of Sleeping Beauty was the beginning of her career as a star of the international opera stage.
They had searched for a voice for Sleeping Beauty for 3 years, and I feel that probably the reason Walt Disney chose me to sing the part of the Princess Aurora was because I could easily negotiate my voice in the high register. And it was almost like an extension of speech for me because I'd sung that way since I was a little girl. I never lost that, and I know that he wanted everything to be in the Tchaikovsky classical style, but he wanted it to be easily understood and warm and young and joyful with a romance in it, and that's the way I felt when I was doing the music.
And bring back a love song to me.
Because of its strong reliance on classical music, Sleeping Beauty was recorded in state-of-the-art stereophonic sound. Similarly, its magnificent art and epic scope led to the decision to film Sleeping Beauty in the widescreen 70mm format.
Sleeping Beauty is the first full-length animated feature photographed in what we call Technorama 70. Our previous features like Snow White, Pinocchio, and Cinderella were made for the standard size theater screen. So they were shot on 35mm film like this. But Sleeping Beauty was filmed in Technorama 70 like this. That meant that all of our artwork, backgrounds, paintings had to be larger and more detailed.
All of these special processes and meticulous attention to detail had a cost, not just in money, but in the time it took to produce Sleeping Beauty. In addition to the complexity of Sleeping Beauty's production, Walt Disney and his staff were stretched thin, hard at work on Disneyland, three television series, and numerous live-action films.
That's why it took us 6 years and $6 million to make Sleeping Beauty. But to us, it was worth it.
I mean, at every step, this film was going to be different. And that meant much more work. This was not business as usual for anybody at the studio.
The picture was in animation longer than any picture I'd ever worked on, and since then either.
It was so complex in its design statement that normally a background for a film might take a day or two. I think on an average for Sleeping Beauty, it'd be at least a week, maybe 10 days sometimes.
For myself, it was wonderful. I got to paint most of the production backgrounds of the whole picture, where it never could have been that way if it had been rushed.
Sleeping Beauty premiered in the era of epic movies like Ben-Hur. But as was the case with many other epics, Sleeping Beauty was a gamble. Since it first opened, however, Sleeping Beauty has become one of the most financially successful films released in 1959, second only to Ben-Hur. And Sleeping Beauty has influenced a whole new generation of young people who have become the leaders of today's Walt Disney feature animation.
I think it's something that our current generation of animators have taken greatly to heart in trying to make our current films stylistically and graphically as different from one another as we can. It's a level of craftsmanship to which we can all still aspire.
Sleeping Beauty is certainly ranks right there among the top most influential graphic films in the Disney canon.
In my family, ever since I was 5 years old, I was known as the guy who wants to work at Disney. So we know who to blame. It's Sleeping Beauty and those brilliant designers, and it's Disney at its best.
Little did I know, Sleeping Beauty would be the film that would keep me in contact with young people. When I'm talking to young people, tell them to hold on to their dreams, work very hard. I was very lucky and so fortunate. It was a once upon a dream. And I loved every minute of it.